The number of cases of COVID-19 outside China has increased 13-fold.
Coronavirus, of course, front and center, a record average of more than 80,000 cases a day now.
But perhaps there is no nation on earth with a bigger crisis than India.
Let's get the latest on the situation
across. Have already come up in India in the last 24 hours, 85,362.
Sampurna lockdown hone ja raha hai.
If anything kills over 10 million people in the next few decades, it's most likely to be a highly infectious virus rather than a war.
These were the words of philanthropist Bill Gates in 2015 in his TED Talk, "The Next Outbreak, We Are Not Ready." In 2020, humankind is facing a disruptive pandemic, COVID-19. Is this the first pandemic the world faced so far? No. So, where did it all begin? Throughout history, as humans spread across the world, infectious diseases have been a constant companion. Even in this modern era, outbreaks are nearly endless. There were many diseases in the early centuries which caused severe life loss, like the Great Plague of London in 1665, causing the death of nearly 20% of London's population at that time. The first cholera pandemic in 1817, in which more than 150,000 people were dead. The Russian flu, killing more than 360,000 people in 1889, followed by the Spanish flu, resulting in 50 million deaths worldwide in 1918. The Asian flu in 1957, and HIV in 1981, all of which changed the world. Along with this, hundreds of new viruses were found in the 20th century and led to many more deaths. Later in the 21st century, severe acute respiratory syndrome, SARS, affected the human respiratory system. Later in 2014, Ebola pandemic 2 spread very quickly. And we had been warned.
You saw this coming years ago. No one really listened to you then.
I listened to you.
A lot of people watch your TED Talk, but the changes weren't made.
As of now, mentioning the very recent one, COVID-19 is the world's biggest outbreak after the Spanish flu of 1918. The coronavirus was first found in the city of Wuhan. The deadly virus spread throughout the city, crippling the health infrastructure. By the end of March, around 300,000 cases were confirmed worldwide as the heart of the pandemic shifted from China to the UK and the USA. As of now, 75 million cases have been registered worldwide with over 1.6 million deaths. Also, these pandemics will affect the environment and will further accelerate the rate of climate change. Climate change has already made conditions more favorable to the spread of some infectious diseases and waterborne diseases, which cause vomiting and diarrhea, along with mosquito-borne diseases such as malaria and dengue fever. Future risks are not easy to foretell, but climate change hits hard on several fronts that matter to when and where pathogens appear, including temperature and rainfall patterns. To help limit the risk of infectious diseases, we should do all we can to vastly reduce greenhouse gas emissions and limit global warming to 1.5 degrees. Animals around the world, some of which can be home to pathogens like the flu that can make people sick. We also have massive concentrations of people in cities where diseases transmitted by sneezing may find fertile ground. And we have the ability to travel around the globe in less than a day and share germs widely. The rapid dismantling of life on Earth owes primarily to habitat loss, which occurs mostly from growing crops and raising livestock for people. Another major cause of species loss is climate change. Historically, we have grown as a species in partnership with the plants and animals we live with. So, When we change the rules of the game by drastically changing the climate and life on Earth, we have to expect that it will affect our health. We all need to take a stand to prevent the next pandemic. We also need to take climate action to prevent it. Rethinking our agricultural practices, preventing deforestation, reducing air pollution caused by burning fossil fuels, and decreasing greenhouse gas emissions can control the change. In the near future, when COVID-19 eases and we are ready to restart our lives and the economy, we can make our workforce healthier and more climate resilient through scaling up our investments in low carbon technologies. The worst awaits. This is the apocalypse. A daffodil has poked its head up from the dirt and opened sunny arms to bluer skies. Yet, I am filled with dark and anxious dread as theaters close, as travel ends, and grocery stores display the empty rows where cleaners, liquid bleach, and bags of flour stood in upright ranks.